cane sugar. So this cane sugar is not being bleached, so you can see it has a slight kind of like brownish tint, and I can pass it along as well. Let me see. I haven't been making such a little tiny amount for a very long time, so I'm gonna be like cheating and looking. But I'm gonna pass this. I really noticed when you give something to people to smell and to touch, you can remember better. But it's maybe because I have two small children. I'm not sure. And the third ingredient is tea. And we use a blend of three teas. We use black tea, green tea, and oolong. I got up today at 4 o'clock, so I couldn't dig my oolong tea, so I just brought you two teas. Traditionally, it's made with black tea. It needs presence of caffeine. Again, you do not want to use decaf. You're not tricking kombucha. You can trick yourself. The reason we use blend of the tea is it's almost like when you blend wine. You just bring in different kind of flavor profiles. You know, the green tea, it's very grassy. It's like a cut pasture. Black tea, it's like, you know, oaky. Oolong tea, it's very floral, very meadowy-like. The one tea you do not want to use is hibiscus is not a tea, it's a tea sap, it's herb. You don't want to use mint tea. We're talking about the real tea plant, which contains natural amount of caffeine. Some people ask if they can use flavored tea. You can use flavored tea. The only ones tea you want to stay away that's flavored is some kind of oil. Like for instance, Earl Grey, because it has bergamot oil. The reason you don't want to have oil, you don't want anything to compete with your culture, which is somewhere passing around. So you want to make sure that anything you use is not gonna compete with that culture. For this reason, you don't want to use honey as a sweetener, because honey is antibacterial and antiviral, and again, it might compete with your culture. I always get one person who's gonna raise up hand and say, "Thank you, Kira. This is my daughter, Kira." Well, I did a decaf and it's worked out. Sure thing, it might work out. It's just what I'm trying to say. It's not the optimal condition for your kombucha. It's not gonna thrive as good. It's almost like us human going and eating McDonald's every day. You're gonna live for a while, but you know, maybe not that well. Bad example. Right? So there's the recipe. Did everybody get the recipe who wanted the recipe? And if not, as I said, just, you know, send me email. I will be more than happy to send you the recipe. So we start with 1 gallon of water. So as I said, you know, make sure the water is filtered. If you have your the well water, thank you, it's totally fine. It's just you want to make sure that it's not too high in, you know, copper or chlorine. It's one of those, you know, things. And what I did, I boiled 2 cups of water, and now I'm gonna add 1 tablespoon of organic tea. So you can directly add it to the boiling water just like that. You just need to have a sieve or strainer, or you can have a little tea bags. So just, you know, kind of the same thing. You can either do that, but you have to strain it, or you can have a little tea bag. Those tea bags I bought at Bed Bath & Beyond, they have spice bags. And I think you can buy, like, I think it's, yeah, 4 reusable bags, and they're all reusable. So you can buy one for yourself and give it to your 3 friends. They'll be happy. So you just get 1 tablespoon of tea, and I'll just use black tea for the example. And when your water comes to boil, you're gonna infuse it for 7 minutes. Again, a lot of questions. Wow, can I do it 9 minutes? Sure thing. You know, the only reason I say 7 minutes, don't forget it for like days and days, because what's gonna happen, it's gonna oversteep and your mixture gonna be too bitter. You wanna make sure you got all the tannins, but it's not too deep. So mixture came to boil, and you're just gonna infuse for 7 minutes. The reason I brew only 2 cups, and I'm gonna add the rest, I'm gonna add the water, is simply because you can save the time. If you boil whole entire 1/2 gallon and infuse it, well, it's gonna take much longer to cool it down. That's the only reason, you know. So to me, I'm kind of busy, you know. I just want to make sure I can do it as fast as I possibly can. So kombucha is really interesting culture. It thrives at the temperature between 76 and 82 degrees. It's like kombucha loves Palm Beach, right? It feels really good. I'm going to Palm Beach and it's just all there. When it's not Palm Beach, when it's in New York City in February, kombucha just kind of like slows down, right? And so the process of making kombucha, how long you have to ferment it, depends how cold or how warm it is outside. So in the winter time, it's gonna take much longer. It could take up to 3 weeks. In the summer time, it could be just only 6 days. So the low temperature just slows down proliferation and growth of the scurvies and the fermentation process. And the summertime, opposite, it's very, very heavy. So what's gonna happen if it's cold? It's just gonna be slower. But if it's too hot, you really, really will make sure that you kind of measure the temperature, because if it's too hot, you're gonna poach the scoby and it's probably not gonna survive. So how hot it is, you know, some people go really geeky and they just measure this thermometer. If you have a thermometer and you just wanna do it, it's totally fine. However, you can just kind of check it with your finger, be totally honest with you. When we sell our kits, we put a little thermometer that I buy at the pet store for the aquariums, so you can just put it on, it's easy to see and you always have it so you don't really lose it. So, I'm gonna be like Rachel Ray, I'm gonna turn around, 7 minutes past, everything's infused, you got your bag out. And now you're gonna add your half cup of sugar. So if you forgot, you start infusing and you forgot and you went away in 2 hours, it's totally fine. You just need to rewarm your mixture again, because the warm mixture, you need to melt your sugar. That's what you need to bring, you know. You want to make sure when you dissolve your sugar, just make sure it's completely dissolved. So my mixture is going to be a little bit lighter than if you make your own, because I didn't really infuse it for 7 minutes. And also, the water wasn't really boiling. It's kind of little things. So everything dissolved. Everything is nice and infused. And then you have, so before you even started this, it's almost like when you buy the puppy. You don't just go buy a puppy and then you bring it home and you say, oops, I forgot my little mattress for the puppy. It's happened to me, really. So I had to go and run to the Kmart and buy the, you know, puppy things. You want to make sure you want to get this little house first. So you want to find the jar. You need to find where you're going to brew your kombucha. It's really nice to find the jar that has large opening, because kombucha does need oxygen. It's aerobic culture. It needs oxygen to get and grow. So, you know, jar like this, which could be, you know, half a gallon, or jar like this could be half a gallon. So you want to look for the larger opening of your jar. So this jar has been found, which is really nice and perfect. So you get your infused tea and you fill it up with this, your filtered water. And you want to pour your water enough to the widest opening of the jar. So it's not very good idea to fill it till here. It's just nice to do it where the widest opening. And you're ready. So what else do you need to do is you need to add what's gonna call starter. And the starter is nothing but kombucha from the previous batch. So when you order your scoby, it's gonna already come with the starter. And for your next batches, you're just gonna be reserving this half a cup of the old kombucha and you add it there. So you're gonna measure half a cup of your kombucha starter. And what starter does, kind of like a kickstart to the growth, because the starter will contain all this, it will acidify your liquid much faster. And then you add your scoby. So my scoby is huge. The scobies we have at our brewery is exactly the same diameter as our vats. So our vats are like this big. So we have a giant scope is that we actually have to have two people to lift it up. So when you get it from where you order the SCOBYs, you know, that's probably gonna be really nice, cute, tiny, little white SCOBY because it's just, you know, they just do it and grow them for this specific reason. They call it SCOBY nursery. I used to do it anytime I did the, it's all gonna hurt, it's okay. Every time I would do the class, I would grow little SCOBYs. And you know, it's all cute and all nice and it's little jars. What I found is, like, why do I do this? I already have big, giant working SCOBYs. We can just cut a slice of SCOBY. SCOBYs, first time I did this, I saw this lady, she was like, oh my God, don't touch it, it's hurt. It's not, you know, it's not a hamster. It's not gonna hurt, and the reason for this is because it's the bacteria and yeast bound together, remember? So it's really not possible to hurt it because it's individual many things. So we're just gonna slice a little slice of SCOBY. And it's very interesting texture. Texture like a very, very overcooked scallop. Or maybe very, very overcooked calamari, even better. So you just get the piece and you're gonna add it. And two things gonna either or. It's gonna either float or sink. It's almost like when you're pregnant, you're gonna have either girl or boy. There is really no other options. So, is it? Oh no, see, it's floating. So it's all happy. We touched it before. Make sure it's really nice and not too cold, not too warm. And I will pass it for you to touch. Then you have a little bonnet. And this is to keep things away from your kombucha. So I do highly recommend not to cover this cheesecloth. The reason for this is cheesecloth is too porous. And you know, your little tiny fruit flies are your biggest, worst enemies in the summertime. They are nasty. It's extremely hard to get rid of them. They lay eggs. For some reason for cheesecloth kombucha cover. I don't know why I want to do that. So what we use organic cotton. You can get, I have like different ones. I did something for Christmas with the little, you know, sugar canes, and we're gonna have little bunny for Easter. You know, you wanna make kombucha happy, you know, why not? And a little rubber band. You cover this up, and because you're really proud and responsible owner, you already found the space for it to keep it. It doesn't have to be in a dark place. It doesn't have to be anything special. What it has to be away from the sunlight. You don't wanna put it on the little, you know, windowsill. And you wanna put it away from the wind blowing. So you don't wanna put, you know, your balcony door and your other door, the kombucha right there, the sun is shining. Countertop is great. Pantry is great. The only thing I recommend, and you're gonna think I'm, you know, I'm silly, but it's kind of true. You wanna put it somewhere on your eye level. Because what's gonna happen? You're gonna be so excited for hot few 2 weeks, and you're gonna be constantly touching it and moving it. And every time you move it, you just kind of destroy this from this new SCOBY from forming. So you know, find little space, either on your countertop, on your pantry, and just leave it there. So what's gonna happen is this SCOBY gonna start gobbling out the sugar, which is real and it loves it, and it's gonna form new SCOBY on top. So your first SCOBY is just to start your new mother, which would be really, you know, start of your new kombucha brewing. The cool thing is that SCOBY is gonna be exactly the same diameter as the opening of your jar. So if you wanna have star-shaped SCOBY, just gonna get star-shaped jar and you're all set, right? So my daughter actually had, she got like a, oh, she has a heart shape. So, you know, here it is. And in the beginning, that's why it's important not to touch it all the time. You will see probably in 2 days, you will see a little skin forming. It's almost like gonna be as thin as the plastic wrap. And then it's gonna get thicker and thicker and thicker. and eventually you will see it's nice and white kind of layer on top. So as I said, the first batch is gonna be for you to grow your own SCOBY. This was just a little start. I just gave it like a little kickstart. So the first kombucha probably gonna be overly fermented for you to drink because you were waiting until the SCOBY is formed. If you, you know, I usually say, you know, try starting it in like 5 days. How does it taste? But in 5 days for your first batch, it's probably gonna be too thin. And if you move it, it's gonna be hard for you to kind of probably rip it apart. So the first kombucha, it would be a little bit, you know, it would be too sour to taste. So you wait, you know, a little bit longer, and when you see the film is nicely formed, then you really feel, you know, you can comfortably remove it. You know, we use gloves. If you wash your hands just for your own consumption, make sure you wash your hands. Just remove it, reserve the starter, and just start again. So there you go. Very easy, very, very simple. I think we all should start, you know, should make our kombucha. The one thing is, always somebody asks, and I will take your questions right now, but always I have one person who always says, well, I read it's dangerous, you can die. So I gotta ask you this question. How often do you open your news, source of news, whatever you use, and say, so many people died from kombucha poisoning? None. And the reason for this is, by the time kombucha is ready, and you taste it, the reason you know it's ready, only you're gonna know it's ready. You know, kombucha, when it's kombucha ready for me, might be completely too sour for you or too sweet. You know, you only the one who's gonna determine. Usually, as I said, normal temperature, June, it's about 7 days, but it could be much longer, it could be much shorter. So the reason it's not possible to die from kombucha, because you know, you're all smart people, you have your eyes, you have your nose, you can smell. By the time kombucha is ready, the pH is about 3.4, 3.6. It's a way too acidic for any other bacteria to survive. Pretty much kombucha is just so resilient that it killed up all the other bacteria. That's how strong that is. But the only time, and you can see, like, you do not know if it's something wrong with this, is you will see the mold growing. And the only time the mold will be growing is because your kombucha, your SCOBY was not strong enough, and it didn't turn this tea acidic in a timely fashion, that the pathological, all the mold started to grow. You know, I can tell you from all my years I've been brewing kombucha, never ever happened to me. I've never seen the mold. If you see the mold, don't drink it. But I think it kind of goes to bread, cheese, meat, everything else, right? Like you don't really eat this. So that's the whole little thing. And if you see the mold, that's the one thing you don't want to solve the problem. If you see the mold, I would highly recommend discard everything and clean the jar, and clean your hands and just clean it up. So most of the time, if you buy from the reputable supplier, you have no problem like this. You're gonna have so much kombucha, you're gonna be like giving it away and start your own kombucha company. That's it. Well, looks like my half an hour was way too short. If you have any questions, please.
I'm finding so many different mentalities. It seems challenging. I don't say hard, because the only thing hard is the concrete that you walk on, everything else is a challenge. So I'm ready.